الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. إن شاء الله with the last part of سورة النازعات، we reached verse number 34. فإذا جاءت الطامة الكبرى. So we recite إن شاء الله recite after me. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. فإذا جاءت الطامة الكبرى يوم يتذكر الإنسان ما سعى وبرزت الجحيم لمن يرى فأما من طغى وآثر الحياة الدنيا فإن الجحيم هي المأوى وأما من خاف مقام ربه ونهى النفس عن الهوى فإن الجنة هي المأوى يسألونك عن الساعة أيان مرساها فيما أنت من ذكراها إلى ربك منتهاها إنما أنت منذر من يخشاها كأنهم يوم يرونها لم يلبثوا إلا عشية أو ضحاها فإذا جاءت الطامة الكبرى. جاءت four counts or five counts. الطامة is longer, six counts. And then you have the ميم والشدة takes two counts. So you say it like this. فإذا جاءت الطامة الكبرى. So this is the mad with it. فإذا جاءت الطامة الكبرى, which means, but when there comes the greatest طامة. Catastrophe, which is basically referring to the day of judgment. فَإِذَا جَاءَتْ, and when the day of judgment comes. And the meaning of this, it refers to the day of judgment, but the day of judgment has names, and the names has meanings to it. And الطَّامَّة, something that is, as it's mentioned, great catastrophe, or it's the it's something that is major calamity. And when something overflows, something that is too much, as they say, the river Tammanah, when the river floods. So the calamity is not just any calamity. It's, if there's any calamity, the day of judgment is far worse than any calamity that a person can think of, because in it is the everlasting either hellfire or a'udhu billah, and that's what the calamity of it. So this is Tammatul Kubra. And Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he said, "Summiyat bidhalik." Why it was called at-tamma? He said, "لأنها تطم على كل أمر هائل مفزع." Because it covers any other huge and catastrophe or a calamity. It overpowers this, overcovers all of this. So if someone think of any musiba, the musiba in the day of judgment is far more than anything altogether. And this is one of the ways that even a person would feel or would seek some relief or ease in with regards to the masaib or the calamities in this life, is to think of what's worse and what's waiting. You know, the masaib, the calamities in this life, if the day of judgment, when a person is in the day of judgment, he will consider that nothing. And also, as they would mention, the death of a loved one, for example, when they say that the death of the Prophet ﷺ was a bigger musibah than the death of your loved one. So when you remember the death of the Prophet ﷺ, then your musibah, the calamity in the death of a loved one, is a lesser one, gives you ease. Right? So this is Tammatul Kubra, which is the day of judgment. And this is one of the meanings of it. That's what Imam al-Sa'di rahimahullah says, that this major difficulty or the major thing in the day of judgment, that any shidda, any difficulty becomes so little when a person remember فَإِذَا جَاءَتِ الطَّمَّةُ الْكُبْرُ, the major one. On that day when a person would not even care about his own son or a mother towards her own son or vice versa, or friend to a friend or a wife to a husband, all of these things is no matter to the person except to save himself from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And since the surah is talking about the day of judgment and those who deny the day of judgment, so then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the end of the surah mentions some of the things of the day of judgment as it's always repeated in the Quran. يَوْمَ يَتَذَكَّرُ الْإِنسَانُ مَا سَعَى. On that day, one man shall remember what he strove for. يَوْمَ, the day of judgment, يَتَذَكَّرُ الْإِنسَانُ, the human being would remember. Would remember, يَتَذَكَّرُ الْإِنسَانُ, يَتَذَكَّرُ, remember what he did in the dunya, in this life that we're living in now. مَا سَعَى, what he did, what he سَعَى, that means the actions that a person did, from good or bad. He would wish then that he can increase even the weight of a dharra of hasanat, and it would make him so sad and miserable, the weight of a mustard seed or the smallest thing of sayyat. فَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَى وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ شَرًّا يَرَى. Person would see it. So therefore, this is the time before the regret comes in the day of judgment, that a person would make sure that he would wipe in his book of deeds all evil and would increase as much as he can from the good deeds. يَوْمَ يَتَذَكَّرُ الْإِنسَانُ مَا سَعَى أَنْ أَتَّائِبُ مِنَ الذَّنْبِ كَمَنْ لَا ذَنْبَ لَهُ. The person repents to Allah as if he never had the sin. So this is the day when people or the human being would remember what he did. يتذكر بسنة وساعة وبرزت الجحيم لمن يرى. Verses very precise, very clear. And the hellfire al-jahim shall be made apparent in full view for everyone who sees. وبرزت الجحيم. برزت, from برزة, and بروز is when something becomes apparent or it's clear from the earth, not from the flat earth. But and that's why البروز, even they call it on a person's body, there's a bump. Something that is, shown, or in the, anything that is shown. So burrizat al-jahim, and with a shadda, not just barazat, burrizat. That means it's very clearly become apparent and in front of the people, uzhirat, shown. And al-jahim is one of the names of the fire. And al-jahim, linguistically, it's the fire in a pit inside the ground. They call it jahim. So, of course, it doesn't necessarily mean that the Jahim and the hereafter is like this, but this is one of the names of the fire. That word specifically, they use it for when the fire is under the ground in a hole or something like this. وَبُرِزَتِ الْجَحِيمُ لِمَنْ يَرَى, for those who to see, which is everybody. People will see it. And that's to show that, to bring the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of what people will see. And with what's mentioned about the fire, and that would make the person forget all desires and all good things that he did in his life. And this is the place going to be for the disbelievers, for the sinners. So nothing was worth subjecting oneself to this. So then, فَأَمَّا مَنْ طَغَى. The hellfire will be brought in front of the people in the day of judgment and takes away the disbelievers. فَأَمَّا مَنْ طَغَى. So as a result of that, the people of two categories. And the categories are mentioned by their characteristics. فَأَمَّا مَنْ طَغَى, as for the one that طَغَى, transgressed. الطُغْيَان is the transgression. So as for the one that طَغَى, and الطُغْيَان, he went over the limits. There are limits that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala set. Limits not to transgress beyond these limits. Limits in forbidden actions, and limits in even the ta'a, the acts of ibadah, there are limits. Don't do more than what you have been ordered to do, whether it's obligation or recommended acts. So for those who transgress, and the transgression can be either in state of kufr or sin. So those who did the evil sins, بأن تجرأ عن معاصي الكبار, he was doing the major sins, and he was not satisfied with what Allah put a limit. And this is again, when a person reflects upon the sins are like this. They should be satisfied with what Allah made the limit for us. He's the creator of the heavens and the earth, and he created this life, and he created us, and he told us, like he said to Adam alayhi salam, you have the entire Jannah, but don't eat from that one particular tree. So the same thing, a person has this life and the air to breathe and food and drink and all kinds of good things, but do not do this and this, which is counting things of haram. فَأَمَّا مَنْ طَغَى. So this is one of the characteristics of the people of the Hafair, طُغْيَان, they transgress the limits. That's the second thing is وَآثَرَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا. آثَرَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا, and preferred the life of this world by following his evil desires and lusts. And the word used, وَآثَرَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا, from al-ithar. That means he chose this one over the other one. This is what al-ithar is. It's one or the other, not both. So he made طغيان, and as Imam Sa'di says, وَآثَرَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا عَلَى الْآخِرَةِ فَصَارَ سَعْيُهُ لَهُ. He chose this dunya over the hereafter, so his sa'i, his actions becomes for this worldly one. And his time, وَقْتُ مُسْتَغْرَقًا, his time is fully used or wasted in the حُظُوظِهَا وَشَهَوَاتِهَا, in its fortune and its goodness and its desires and lusts and so on. وَنَسِيَ الْأَخِرَةِ, and he forgot the hereafter, and he left the actions to be for the hereafter. وَآثَرَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا, and it doesn't mean that a person would not have the love of this dunya. This is installed in each and everyone. But whoever chooses this life over the hereafter, and the sign of that is a person is having the tughyan or the transgression, and whether it's in disbelief or disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and so on. فَإِنَّ الْجَحِيمَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى. So therefore, al-jahim, or the hellfire, is their abode, their place. Their place forever for the disbelievers. And if the jahim is their place, what they eat, what they drink, is as mentioned in the Quran, al-zakum, and al-hamim, and so on. فَإِنَّ الْجَحِيمَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى. On the other side, وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى. Usually when the ayat of the Quran talks about believers, disbelievers, characteristics in the same context, pay attention to these characteristics versus what's the opposite of it on the other side. You would find many great benefits and meanings there. So for the believers, وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ, which is opposite to what? الطُغْيَان. فَأَمَّا مَنْ طَغَى. So for the believers, what would make the person away from transgressing the limits? Al-khawf, to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ. But what is the meaning of خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ? He feared the مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ has two meanings, which is the مَقَام, standing. So he would fear the fact that he would stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would judge his actions and so on. So that خَوْف, that fear of that moment or that thing that would happen to him, made him away from الطغيان and transgression. And the other meaning of مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ, meaning he feared feared Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That this is the meaning of مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ, feared Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, regardless of the standing physically to be judged. So I خَافَ الْقِيَامَ عَلَيْهِ وَمُجَزَاتِ بِالْعَدْلِ, that he feels that when he was standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that affected his heart. So what he did, then he stayed away from what Allah forbade. خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى. وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى, which means forbade himself from the desires. As for the disbelievers, فَأَمَّا مَنْ طَغَى وَآثَرَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا. So as a sign for the believers that they don't choose this dunya over the hereafter, is that they forbid themselves from their desire, the sinful desires. So that's a sign that he's not choosing this dunya over the hereafter, because he has limits. He forbid for himself what is sinful, and he would instead do what's halal. If the halal is not feasible, then he should be patient. He should make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Ya ma'ashar al-shabab, man istata'a minkum al-ba'ata falyatazawwaj. Wa man lam yastata' fa'alayhi bis-sawm, fa'innahu lahu wijaa. O young people, you should get married. And if you're not able to get married, then fast. Because this will be a means of protection for you. So, wa amma man khafa maqama rabbihi wa naha al-nafs. And nafs, as it's mentioned in the Quran, as if it's something separate from oneself. You have to forbid yourself from al-hawa. Al-hawa takes a person down, and that's the desires. فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى. Indeed, the Jannah is the abode opposite to the hellfire, that is the ma'wa of the disbelievers. This is his place. And in the Jannah, there's all kinds of delight, as it's mentioned in the Quran. And then يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ السَّاعَةِ أَيَّانَ مُرْسِحَ. They ask you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, about the hour, when will be its appointed time, since the surah talks about those who deny the day of judgment. يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ السَّاعَةِ أَيَّانَ مُرْسَاهَا. When it's going, al-marsa is when, again, when the ship, what's the word that they use when the ship reaches the harbor and it settles down and it stops? Docks. Nah. So this is exactly what the word means. So the time when the hour will be established. And those who ask these questions, the disbelievers, those who deny the Ba'ath, the believers, they don't ask this. The believers are more concerned of how to be obedient to Allah, and they have the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they ask you, عَنِ السَّاعَةِ, when it's going to be established, أَيَّانَ مُرْسَاهَا. فِيمَ أَنْتَ مِنْ ذِكْرَاهَا, which means you have no knowledge to say anything about it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving this answer to them. فِيمَ أَنْتَ مِنْ ذِكْرَاهَا, that means what is the benefit for you or for them to know when it's going to happen. There's no results to this. And since there is no benefit for them to know when is the hour, and the benefit is for it to be hidden from them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the knowledge of the establishment of the hereafter only to him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not even the angel that would blow in the trumpet. No angel, nor even Jibreel alayhi salam, know when the hour will be established. So, and they're asking, they're questioning, they're asking as a way of ridiculing, and not that they're seeking knowledge or anything like this. And as they say, إِذَا مَتَ الْعَبْدُ قَمَتْ قِيَامَتُ. If a person dies, his qiyamah is established. So it's not something that is too far, because the death and what comes afterwards in the grave, this is the first stages of the hereafter. إِلَى رَبِّكَ مُنْتَهَى. يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ السَّاعَةِ أَيَّانَ مُرْسَاهَا فِيمَ أَنْتَ مِنْ ذِكْرَاهَا. So those who claim that they know when is the hour is going to be established and all of that, this is all lies. And it's something to be turned away from. إِلَى رَبِّكَ مُنْتَهَاهَا, which means to your Lord, is the knowledge of the term thereof. إِلَى رَبِّكَ مُنْتَهَاهَا, the end of it. مُنْتَهَا, الانتهاء of something is the end of things. That means the knowledge of it is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as it's mentioned many verses in the Quran, one of which is أَلُونَكَ عَنِ السَّاعَةِ أَيْنَ مُرْسَاهَا, the same beginning of the verse, قُلْ إِنَّمَا عِلْمُهَا عِنْدَ رَبِّي. Say, indeed, the knowledge of it is with my Lord. لَا يُجَلِّيهَا لِوَقْتِهَا إِلَّهُ. He would not reveal its time, only him, subhanahu wa ta'ala, till the end of the ayat. So, إِلَى رَبِّكَ مُنْتَهَا. And the مُنْتَهَا, and the end of all things is to Allah. So people should rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ مُنْذِرُ مَنْ يَخْشَاهَا. Indeed, you are, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مُنْذِرُ مَنْ يَخْشَاهَا. You are a warner for those who fear it. So warning the people from the Day of Judgment. Who will benefit from it? Those who fear the Day of Judgment. As for those who disbelieve in it, they're not going to benefit from the warning. Because those who believe in it, they would fear their standing in it in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So as a result of that, they have no concern in this life except to prepare themselves for the hereafter. And everything becomes to serve that concern and the end, which is the hereafter. Even their goodly things, even their worldly matters is for that sake, to prepare themselves for the hereafter. إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ مُنْذِرُ مَنْ يَخْشَهَا كَأَنَّهُمْ يَوْمَ يَرَوْنَهَا لَمْ يَلْبَثُوا إِلَّا عَشِيَّةً أَوْ ضُحَهَا. Which means the day they see it, it will be as if they had not tarried in this world except an afternoon or morning. كَأَنَّهُمْ يَوْمَ يَرَوْنَهَا. which means when they are resurrected in the Day of Judgment, they come out from their graves to Al-Mahshar, to the land of the Day of Judgment. When they see it then, they would belittle so much this worldly life that they lived in. They would see how short this life is, to the extent of which is that لَمْ يَلْبَثُوا إِلَّا عَشِيَّةً أَوْ ضُحَاهَا, as if they only stayed in this life عَشِيَّةً. Al-Ashiyya is what? Is between Dhuhr till Maghrib. This is the عَشِيَّةَ, literally. It's part of the day, part of the night, yes, but the word عَشِيَّةَ is from Dhuhr till Maghrib. أَوْ ضُحَاهَا, the Duha is from the sunrise till Dhuhr time. So it's all part of the day. So كأنهم يوم يرونها لم يلبثوا إلا, not even as if they would see this dunya as if they stayed for one day, no, as if they stayed either the first half of the day or the second half of the day. And this is all means of of reminders of the reality of how things will be, so that a person would benefit from it and believe in the Day of Judgment. And the disbelievers, they disbelieve, so they ought to believe. And for the believers, their life should be according to to what they believe. And it's a very disturbing thing when the practical life of a believer becomes like the practical life of the disbelievers. They don't believe, so their life is according to what they disbelieve in. But for the believer, his life should be according to what he believes in. So they are in place where they believe in or they disbelieve in. The believers should be also according to what they believe in, their actions and their life, everything based on matters of the hereafter and the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's why some of the words that we saw here, Abu Rizat, as we mentioned, the meaning of it, and also Tagha, and Al-Ithar, Wa-Athar Al-Hayat Al-Dunya. As we said, al-ithar is to prefer something over something else. And when you see really looking into that word, or the same three letters that comes with it, which is al-athar. Al-athar is the footsteps or the traces of something, which is even the slightest thing, which is what a person would be choose to follow, basically over something else. Wa-athar al-hayat al-dunya fa-innal فَإِنَّ الْجَحِيمَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى. The hellfire is al-ma'wa, and al-ma'wa is the abode or the place of rest, and comes from alif waw ya, which is the refuge. And al-ma'wa, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from the hellfire. The benefits of what we need to really learn from the surah, there are so many, of course, but when we look at the surah and how the belief of the hereafter is something that should be established in the hearts of the believers. And the verses talks about those who deny the Day of Judgment and what they are going to face. So, and reminding them and the characteristics of the people of Jannah and the people of the hellfire, how people will be in the Day of Judgment. All of that as an evidence established upon the people to see who will benefit from it and who will deny it and continue to live the life of forgetfulness and lusts and desires. Allahumma musta'an. صلى الله وسلم على محمد وصحبه وسلم.